My name is Mark Reinhold, and I'm the Chief Architect, Java Platform Group. So, a couple of years ago, I don't know how many of you attended my talk at the Eclipse Day. I was Stefan Herman at the time. I have decided to promote myself. I promote myself as the Java Chief Architect. Anyway, to restart, my name is Srikanth, and I work in Oracle as a part of the Lang Tools group, working on the Java language compiler. So if you run Java C, you have run my code, including all the bugs there. So I used to earlier work in the Eclipse JDT compiler team, and I led the Java 8 efforts in Eclipse. And once that shipped, decided it's time to quickly bolt without having to address all the problems and bugs and defect reports, whatever. So I'm here at Oracle today, and I will give a high-level overview of some of the features that we are working on beyond Java 9. Java 9, from a feature set point of view, is closed, and you are probably aware of what is coming in Java 9, so I'll not spend time on that. Most important thing coming up there is module system. So beyond Java 9, what are the things that are cooking is what we are going to cover at a high level. So one of the interesting things that happens in the Oracle Java products group is that at any point in time, there is investigation, prototyping, research, development, implementation work going on for 2-3 releases. There are some of us working on what is likely to be Java 10 work, some of us working on Java 11, you know, some of us are working on things that are not even tagged to any particular release. So a lot of work is happening, people you know, working in a dedicated fashion on things that have nothing to do with Java 9 at all. A lot of this is available for you in the information, as well as source code is available for Valhalla. Valhalla is the code name for the project. Some of the feature set that are being investigated and explored. So documents, design documents, rationals, JEP documents, plus source code repositories, a lot of it is available already for people to take a look at, participate, comment, and get involved in. So you're welcome to do that. So moving on. So this slide is a mandatory slide I need to show. It's basically says that whatever we discuss here is information purposes only, not a commitment to deliver from Oracle. It's not an obligation for Oracle to deliver. You should not rely upon in making, purchasing, or product implementation decisions. So highly speculative. You can just take it that all of this is a lie. So moving on. So two key features that I'm going to give an introduction to that are being considered as part of this project Valhalla. Valhalla is a code name, so I don't know what it stands for. I think it's a lake or a mountain or something. I've forgotten what it is. So is an umbrella term for a collection of features that are being investigated. The two of the core features that come in Valhalla are what are called value types and generic specialization. So those are the two that I'm going to give an introduction on. So beginning with value types, consider this class, a very simple class implementing the abstraction for a complex number, right? Implementing the abstraction for a point. So X and Y represented inside a reference object. This is how you would code it today. And what are some of the problems you have in the present Java 8 implementation or Java 9 implementation in terms of layout, performance, and all that? You can take a look at by considering how this gets represented in memory. To kind of amplify the problem, I'll actually show how this gets represented. An array of points get represented in today's implementation in the JVM and the compiler. So basically, an array is a reference type, so it's an object, and as an object, it has an object header. Every object in Java implementation has an object header which stores certain information that's required by the runtime, such as object identity, virtual tables, so on and so forth. So you have an object header followed by a bunch of references pointing into individual objects that are allocated on the heap, right? So each of the point objects that stores the X and Y for a certain point has its own box, its own object, it's a reference, has its own header, and the array actually holds just references, pointers, into the objects that are actually sitting on the heap. What is wrong with such an arrangement? If you have just a handful of points that you're representing in the array, things are fine. The overhead is not much. But if you have a huge number of points that you need to process, or a huge number of tiny objects that you need to process, hold in an array and process, then the overhead quickly gets very high. The overhead in this case of a point which holds two integers is actually much more than the metadata that the object needs to hold, is much more than the actual payload itself, right? X and Y, two integers, 32 bits, whatever, but the, you know, typically you have object header is typically 8 bytes or 16 bytes based on the implementation. So the metadata overwhelms the actual data that the object has to capture, and when you have a huge number of such tiny objects, millions of them, that you need to represent in your collection, then the overhead quickly gets very high. Overhead is not just in terms of the bytes, that's one part of it. It has other ramifications also, such as, you know, if you take a typical garbage collector, one implementation of a garbage collector could be implementing a generational collection which requires, you know, basically the regions to be scanned and earlier, you know, different generation objects to be migrated to different regions of the heap, right? So objects actually copying collectors. Objects have actually get copied and moved to a different region as the program runs. And that overhead, you can imagine, as you have a large number of tiny objects, the overhead of copying those objects over and over to different generations, different regions gets overwhelming, right? So that is one part of it. A more pernicious problem comes with respect to the fact that reaching into the actual data requires chasing a pointer, right? So you need to, so if you are actually reaching into any of the points X or Y, you need to follow a pointer into the object's location in the heap. What is wrong with that? Basically, the pointer indirection, pointer chasing now, right? The objects are all scattered all over the heap. There is no predictable allocation pattern that you can expect. They are all over the heap, and the access order could be random, which basically means that there could be a lot of cache misses as the objects get accessed, and cache misses carry a huge amount of penalty. There is no locality of reference, as opposed to if this array was where to be an array of integers, and you are scanning through the array, entire array, looking for a certain something, right? The integers are all packed one after the other, other after the other after the other in memory. And as a result, when you access them, there is locality of reference. You are accessing successive memory locations, and the cache fills that result from an earlier cache miss immediately benefit you when you access a subsequent element. And so your program, you know, is not thrashing, you know, not evicting and not running into lots of cache issues there. Here, the allocation is all random. They could be all over the map, and one object could be evicting the other from the cache line. They could all be, you know, overlaid in the cache line as far as the memory layout is concerned, and that could cause a severe performance penalty. When a cache miss is encountered, you know, you really have to, you take a big hit in terms of 200 instructions or 300 instructions worth of cycles are lost in filling the cache, and the pipeline is stalled for that to happen. So a number of such factors like that come into play into or being considered for addressing in Valhalla by coming up with an alternate layout, by coming up with an alternate value class scheme, value type scheme. So one alternative that you can resort to today is to simply use this. So here there is locality of reference that's, you know, you were able to exploit. The X and Y of the point or whatever the complex number, real and imaginary, so you can hold them as two separate array of integers or array of whatever primitive types, and the locality problem is addressed. But what is the problem in this approach? You have basically breaking down the abstraction, right? Instead of representing a point as a point, you have now chosen to represent, you know, you're basically giving up on abstraction, right? So a lot of real-world code, performance-sensitive, performance-intensive code probably does that, and we don't want people to do this. We want Java as a language to recognize that, you know, there are certain problems around this space and have linguistic support, runtime support for that, and that is where the entire idea of the feature of value types comes in. If point could somehow be represented this way, this is the ideal representation. No headers, all inlined. It's one way of looking at value types is to say, you know, just as we're all familiar with inline functions, inline methods, this is inlining of data, right? So just as you're able to have a contiguous array of integers or, you know, your primitives, what if I'm able to avail the same thing with my user-defined types? So values, in a way of looking at it, are user-defined primitives, the support for programmer-defined primitives in the language. So what could it look like? So let's move on to here, let's go back here to ask the question, can, without changing the language, can the JVM do some magic and somehow inline things instead of providing the headers and, you know, scattering the object all over the place? In some extremely limited cases, the VM can do that, but those limitations are so high that in practical cases, you're not going to be able to, the VM is not going to be able to offer real advantage or real benefit to you. What are some of the problems there? So the problems come from the point of view of some basic features that have been there in the language from day one, right? Java allows you to synchronize on any object. You don't need a special kind of lock object or something that you need to create to synchronize a code section. You can just, any object that you have, you can synchronize on it. This requires some metadata to be available. The header goes to support this feature. You need some metadata space to hold the information, to hold the lock, to hold the information that it's locked and whatever. So it's not possible for the VM to predict if it decides to by magic without, you know, there being any language constructs. If the VM today takes your code and lays out an array of points like that, like this, then if somewhere down the line you were to synchronize on a certain element of the array, you have a problem. How do you hold that information and where do you hold that information becomes a problem. So this is something that you cannot do anything about because, you know, programs can pass around references all over the place and you don't know. The VM has very limited view of the world and has no means of knowing that somewhere down the line an array gets passed to somewhere, some method, and that passes it to some other method, and, you know, somebody could synchronize and there's no way for the VM to know, not know. So it has to assume defensively that any object could be synchronized upon. A second problem comes in the fact that you can do a reference comparison like this. Equals equals for reference types basically compares the identity, right? Object identity gets compared as opposed to the object value, right? So the object identity comparison can happen anywhere down the line. If the VM were to inline points, you know, all the elements of the point array inside, how would it materialize the reference all of a sudden when such a comparison is called for, right? So Java doesn't allow you to materialize addresses. There's no language support for materializing addresses within an array, unlike C, where you can do pointer arithmetic and something like that. So here, there's no such possibility. So constructs like this, which are extremely common, would break if the VM were to do some automagic thing there. Yet another problem with that is, you know, there is a method, identity hash code, that basically assumes that objects are in the heap and computes an identity hash code. Your program can, down the line, all of a sudden, at some point, call this method, and it should be possible for it to have an identity and headers and all that stuff. And so this goes to show that what a VM can do without linguistic support is limited, because the VM has no means of really ascertaining at runtime without extremely expensive computation what is possible in a context. What could the linguistic support look like? Well, hypothetically, assume that there is a keyword value. The syntax is provisional. Assume that there is a keyword value which exists and by using which a programmer expresses the intent that, you know, I really want this to be a value class, a user-defined primitive. The moment you stick this in, this certain semantics gets applied to this class. First of all, it's a value, which means that it's like a primitive in certain respects. It does not extend object. Even though it looks like a class, it's declared to be a class, it does not extend object. The class is final. You can't, point does not extend anything, nor can something extend point. It's final. But other than that, it can have fields, it can have methods. because it's a final class, really it doesn't take part in the virtual inheritance and, you know, polymorphic dispatch and all that stuff. Whatever methods you declare are the ones that when you call them, that's where it's going to bind to. There's no subtype possible for that. So you can declare fields, you can declare methods. For all practical purposes, it looks like a class, except it doesn't extend object. It's a final class, and the fields are immutable. Once the value is constructed, it cannot be further changed. Very similar to user-defined primitives, right? If I have an integer x which holds the value 100 at this point, it's possible that you can change x to hold some other value. It's possible for you to change the integer variable x to hold some other value, but it's not possible for you to change the value 100. 100 will always stay 100. In a similar fashion, once this is value instances, we should not say value objects because it could be confusing, these are not objects. Value instances, once they are constructed, are immutable. The class is final, and so from the motto or the goal for the project is that the user-defined primitive value types should, for all practical purposes, from a coding standpoint, look like a class, but it should work like an int, which also means when you pass a value to a method, when you pass a value instance to a method, pretty much it can get passed like integers get passed. Integers get passed in registers. They're not sitting in the heap. Integers get passed in registers, and you know the method can manipulate the value. Any changes that are made don't reflect back. So it's passed by value semantics, right? In a similar fashion, values can be passed if they are suitable, if the compiler and if the runtime determines that it's suitable for passing in registers, values can be passed in registers. So the suitability criteria will very likely involve the size of the object, right? So we are looking at, you know, tiny objects and whatnot. So if it's going to hold a dozen fields, it's not viable to pass it in registers. Unless, you know, you can imagine an implementation that does extremely sophisticated analysis and passes some hot fields in registers and some cold fields somewhere else, but that's a stretch of the imagination. So values can be passed in registers. That's going to be a key performance feature there. And so for all if we succeed, the success criteria for the project is that, you know, for all practical purposes, most of the implementation of value classes should look like a class but work like an int. So what today looks like this, and if values don't extend object or any type, and they cannot be extended also, that really, you know, the entire virtual dispatch and all the machinery that's required to implement virtual dispatch goes away. And one of the implied semantics of sticking in the keyword value there is that you will not be able to, the compiler will now be able to stop you from doing certain things that require metadata in the object, in the instance layout, such as if you attempt to synchronize on a value instance, the compiler will tell you you can't do that. If you call system identity code, the compiler will tell you it can't do that. You can still use equals equals, but the semantics of that is being worked out. The semantics, we know, it will not implement identity comparison because there is no notion of identity for values. So you don't need a virtual table, you don't need metadata to represent runtime type information, locking, and everything goes away. So what used to look like this can now look like this, which is the goal that we started out with, right? So what does this buy you? We discussed three things in the beginning. Locality of reference. As you're iterating through this array, you are not running into cache misses, right? The cache lines get filled not with just the data that you're accessing, but in terms of cache line size, which could be 64 bytes, 128 bytes. So when you touch the first X, a whole block of cache line worth of data gets pulled in, and they are immediately available to you as you iterate further, so performance gets improved. From a garbage collection standpoint, the object is now looks like one contiguous monolithic object as opposed to several, you know, thousands of tiny objects. And the garbage collector, if it's smart, can make a decision not to move this object around as it does generational copying collection, right? It can devise some strategy for dealing with huge objects and not take the hit there. So codes like a class, works like an int. An implementation exists. So your Valhalla, there are repositories that are available. I don't believe they provide early access builds. Pre-built binaries may not be available, but it's fairly easy to set up a repository and build it and experiment with it. So there is already a fairly evolved implementation that you can take a look at and play with. So what are some of the use cases? So any number of representations from different domains are possible. Some common ones that we expect are from the numerics in 128 could be a representation, could have a value class abstraction, complex numbers, decimals, tuples. Tuples can also can be used to implement multiple return values from a method. Optional, which got introduced in JDK 8, was commented in the Java doc as a potential migrant, right? So the Java doc, actually, if you read through the optional Java doc from JDK 8, it actually says, please don't do these operations on this because the future version might migrate this to a value type and your code will break. A bunch of such options. I will give you one detailed example, cursor, which is a faster form of iteration that can be implemented using value types. So optional is a good candidate to migrate to values. It got introduced in Java 8. So basically the streams API, right? So in the streams API, you set up a pipeline with various method calls chained one after the other after the other, and the data flows through the stream. And if one stage of the pipeline could end up returning null, the next stage of the pipeline will have to first check for null before doing its thing, right? So your code is going to look terrible, so which is why optional got introduced there for you to take advantage of. So you basically wrap a value inside optional. So optional can hold a value or hold null, but the optional instance itself is not null, right? So that can flow through the pipeline. So it's a good candidate for converting into value. So it just holds one reference inside it, and you can ask whether the reference is null, or you can get the reference, or if it's null, you can pass a default value and things like that. So getting back to the cursor example, right? So the iterator today looks like this. The interface for iterator looks like this, has a hasNext method. You can query the next element in the iterated collection. You can remove. So your current day implementation could look like this, right? If you have an array iterator, it holds an array of elements, array of some generic element, and it knows the size of the array. It knows it maintains the current element in the variable offset, and you can ask, does it have a next? It implements iterator, so you can ask, does it have a next one more element, and get the next element, right? So fairly straightforward implementation. But if you look at this, right? First of all, this is mutable, right? It's modifying itself. It's modifying its state. Offset is being incremented internally, right? So not a candidate for converting to values as such. And how would the cursor implementation look like, right? So you could iterate it alternatively by using a value class array cursor that could look like this. It implements a cursor of t and, like earlier, holds an array and a notion of where in the array, your cursor position in the array. You can query it, is there more? You can ask for the current one, and when you call next, right, it actually returns the next cursor. This code has a problem there. It says t, it should actually say returns the last method, public t next, should actually read public cursor of t next. So when you ask for the next element, a next cursor, it doesn't mutate itself because values are immutable, like pretty much like user-defined primitive values are immutable. So it instead returns a new cursor, which would carry along with it the notion of where where in the iteration process you are. So it returns a new cursor of array and offset plus one. All right. How would the code look like this? So you materialize a cursor of string, and while the cursor is not empty, do something with the current one. So if you look at this, the cursor C, right, which is a value, very small value, just two elements, can be held, most likely can be held in registers. The cursor instance can be held in registers. Do something, if it's not a horrendously complicated method, can be inlined. C.current, the call on the cursor, is not a virtual call because values don't participate in inheritance. They don't extend, they cannot be extended. So there is a new opcode that's being introduced, invoke direct. So you have a instance and value instance, and you can directly invoke a method on it without consulting virtual tables and whatever. And so the call, yeah. See, that's a good question. It's also a style of programming that, you know, the functional programming and, you know, with immutable thing, and it's not a new problem as such. So to answer your question, I would deflect that question to say it's overall the same question that as, you know, functional programming with immutable objects. So it does create new ones. Perhaps the compiler can inline them, inline the calls, and do certain optimizations there. And it's not a non-issue. So looking at this loop, C can be held in registers. To access the method, to call the method, there is no virtual dispatch with indirection involved. Compiler knows where the call is going. The runtime, VM, knows where the call is going. The call could probably be inlined. And body of the loop, similarly, can be optimized in different ways. So you can end up with a pretty tight implementation of this thing. So one of the complications that comes in evolving a language is when you add a new feature, how well does that feature work with everything else that has been added to the language so far, right? So this problem is getting complexer and complexer as time goes, because, you know, when you implement Java 5, when you are laying out the vision for Java 5, you really have feature set from 1, 2, 3, 4 releases that your new features should interact with, gel well with. At Java 9 time, at Java 10, or whenever, JDK Valhalla is what we call it, right? So we don't put a number to it because we don't know when this will get integrated. So at that point in time, we have at least from, you know, Java 1 to Java 9, the feature set that exists should work in a harmonious fashion with whatever new thing that we are adding there. So if you look at this as a requirement, which is a very hard requirement, you know, you can't build very fantastic features that don't work at all with each other, right? So if you look at this, then one of the interesting complications that comes here is this. Okay, I have values, that's wonderful. They provide me with a bunch of interesting performance characteristics, that's wonderful. How well do they play with the other features in the language? So one of the interesting complications that comes here is, one of the interesting questions that comes here is, can I have values in collections? Or can I, in general, so, you know, can I do new array list of point? This is a huge, huge, huge question, because a point, a value class, is not a reference as such. It does not extend object. And in Java 5, generics implementation, and all the way through till date, right? Generics are implemented in Java by erasure. What we mean by that is to say that if you if you look at array list, class declaration in JDK, it's going to say array class array list of T, right? Where T is the type variable. if no bounds are given for the type variable, which is the case for ArrayList, so it will simply say new ArrayList of T, right? The compiler and the overall implementation assumes that T is some subtype of object. If you just say T, T extends object is the assumption, right? So T is some type, it's a type variable. The variable can assume values which are from the domain of types, all of which must extend object. So T extends object is what the compiler and the language specification treats plain T as. And so if you actually look at the class file, disassemble the class file using Java P command, right? And look at the class file, a method like map, you say get of T and that returns a T, right? At the source code level, the hash map, the map method, get takes a T for the key. It takes a key K and returns a V value, right? But if you look at the class file, the get method would have been compiled down by the compiler to a method that says returns object. Method name is get, takes an object, right? So irrespective of whatever instantiation that your program makes on that particular map, it's guaranteed that the map is can be instantiated only for T values, the type values that are subtypes of objects. And so such an erasure-based implementation scheme works fine. I can have array list of string. I can have array list of integer, the capital I integer. Or I can have array list of something. All that will work because by definition, all of these are reference types. All of these extend object, either directly or indirectly through a chain, and so can be passed to a method that expects an object and encodes an object in its signature, right? So Java implements, unlike C++. C++, on the other hand, does template instantiation by, if I have a, you know, the standard template library, STL in C++ has the vector class, right? So your program may use vector or map or whatever from C++ STL, instantiating it with various concrete types all over the place. A large application that gets built that way, it's very likely, or it's not at all unlikely, that in the binary implementation of the ADA route, or the equivalent of your class file, if you look at it, you may end up with vector of string, vector of this type, vector of that type. Every particular instantiation, basically the compiler takes the code for the template class and sticks in the type variable positions the actual instantiated type, concrete types, generates a class like that, compiles the class, produces the object code for that. So vector of string and vector of integer don't share any code. All the type substitutions are done independently. The classes are compiled, object code is produced. That has its own, lots of complex problems arise out of such an implementation. From an implementation standpoint, as well as from a runtime standpoint, a lot of complications come from that. And in retrospect, the erasure-based implementation in Java has a lot going for it, though it's a fairly tendentious subject. People hold very passionate views on this is broken, that is broken, and things like that. So, but anyway, to return to this problem here, because erasure is the key strategy for implementing. So in Java, you can have, in a particular Java project, you can have array list of thousands of different type concrete types. In the binary level, you're going to have just one class file for array list. Right, so that has the erased object-based implementation, right? Because object is at the root of the hierarchy. Any type, any of the thousand different types that you have can be passed to it, and things are fine. On the other hand, point now is not a subtype of object, and so cannot play well with erasure-based generic implementation. So I cannot pass, I cannot store points in collections unless I do something about it in the language and the implementation of the language. So the problem boils down to really the same thing as saying, can I say new array list of int? You know that you can't. You have to say new array list of integer and involve the boxing cost there, and you can't just store primitives in this thing. So this was okay in Java 5 time because there are only 8 primitives, right? Outside of those 8 primitives, any of the innumerable types you can, any of the innumerable abstractions you can cook up can be stored in collections. Only those 8 are banned, and they incur this performance. There is a workaround for that in the form of the boxed types, and though they incur certain performance penalty there. But now, with values, you're actually opening the door. It's not just 8 limited number of types anymore. You can have, the door is as wide open as reference types, right? You can have any number of abstractions that you want to call out as being value types. Which means that the Java 5, okay, we know that's a problem, we have provided a workaround, people can live with that. That story is not going to work. We need to somehow crack this problem and provide support for instantiating collections or any generic type in general, parameterizing any generic type with any types, including primitives, including values, and references. And so the implementation eventually is going to be a mix of what Java has always done and what C++ has done in terms of, you know, the for all reference types, we will continue with the same story of producing one class file based on erasure. For reference types, we will have to instantiate in the at the file system level. We will have to produce different class files by actually doing the substitutions. And so array, list of string, integer, URL, they all boil down to the same thing. In the new world, this is how it's going to look. All reference types will continue to use the same erased implementation, while there will be specialized classes for integers and values and so on and so forth. So from an implementation standpoint, this raises lots of challenges, because how exactly do you do that? When is the time to do that? Do the specialization, and how do you do that? And what type of metadata needs to be captured for you to do that? You can't go back to the source code, or not often possible. You know, it could be just be a library class that, you know, array list is a library class. You know, you can't do what C++ does. So how do you manage that? You need to carry along a lot of metadata in the class file and make use of that. And the JVM instruction set is also fairly irregular in terms of the references, the bytecode for loading, moving data around are A load and A store, which is what would have been generated for the class, while if you see an array list of int, you need to change it to int I load and I store, and there are additional complications. You know, integers operate on one slot in the stack, while longs and doubles take 2 slots, and that requires, you know, layout issues, and a number of other interesting problems come in. From a language point of view also, a few problems come in, and I'll outline some of the interesting solutions there. So all of them will have the same class here, the different value. These are all, int and point are very similar, as in, you know, they're both values. So int is not really a class and not called out. There's no source code representation for that. So these would have their own separate implementation that's somehow generated. So we have an implementation that works fairly well, which is basically at class loading time. So the compiler, when it generates a class, generates a lot of metadata in the class file that's required to for the specialization. And the specializer, one implementation of that hooks into class loading. And at the class load time, it will see that a certain specialized class is required and take the generic class and specialize that and load that. That's one possible implementation. I mentioned that migrating this requires certain interesting complications, so I'll speak to some of them. First of all, we want the programmer to express an intent that, you know, a generic class that I write, I would want that class to be, I would want the users of the class to be able to parameterize that with any type, including primitives and whatever. Because in the absence of, you know, if that's not going to be required, then we don't want to generate all the metadata and carry that along. So there is a programmer has to first express an intent, and the current syntax for that, which is provisional, is to add a modifier to the type variable. So you basically say, any T should be possible here, right? And if you do that, then basically the compiler knows that T, the domain of T now is the universe of types, values, existing primitives, and existing references. All references, all primitives, whatever, right? So the domain of the type variable T is the universe. Now, that introduces some problems, right? Some complications come in there. So look at the statement data of I equals null, right? Null is necessarily a reference value, a reference instance, a reference, I don't want to say value, it goes with references, right? So if I can't assign, if t is instantiated with int, I can't assign null to int. I can't do that today and I won't be able to do that tomorrow, right? So this is a complication. So what do you do and how do you handle that? And there are different tricks and things that are being considered. Conditional code blocks. So if, so this basically has a lowercase t, this should be capital T. So where ref capital T it should read. And so if T is a reference type, then use this block. Otherwise this block is not applicable. This is a new syntax that's coming up. More interesting problem. This is a much more interesting problem. So the array list has methods today. Let's say remove, and you can provide an index. It will remove the element at that index, or you can say remove and give a T element, and it'll remove, it'll scan the array list and remove that element if it's present. What happens if you instantiate this class, this container, with int? If I want to instantiate it with array list of int, then T gets substituted with int, and now suddenly you end up with two remove methods with the same signature, right? They differ in return types, but return types are not considered in the language for, you know, the whether the method signature is the same or not. So you end up with two instances of remove of int, and that's a problem. So how do I tackle this problem? Well, the way that's done, a way it could be done, is to change remove the int taking remove to remove at, and introduce a where ref t conditional block, and use the old remove method and call the new method. So this basically would allow all the existing code to just work fine. They can continue to use remove of int. Their existing code operating on references in the container can continue to work. They will call this method, which deflects to that method, while the new implementation, any new code, will have to call remove at to work properly with the universe of types that are possible here. So having invented the syntax for conditional blocks, conditional code blocks, there are other tricks that it can be put to use for. For example, if I have an array list of Boolean, so C++ actually allows you to partially specialize templates, or specialize templates, or partially specialize templates. So the compiler by default, C++ compiler by default, will stick in, will substitute your actual concrete instantiated parameter type on top of the variable, and produce the template instantiation. But if you wanted the ability to hand instantiate one specific version, it's possible in C++, and the conditional code block feature allows you to do that. If you want to say, for example, say array list of Boolean, the current implementation would, at best, if you want to take the most efficient implementation, we'll have to have a Boolean array, and that takes space, and you can now try to pack it into bits. All you need is a bit to represent that, and that becomes possible with conditional code blocks. Okay, so that's two features that are in evolution. There is a lot more, and Valhalla is also just one of the projects that are going on at this time. There is also a project Panama, which is looking into object layout arrays 2.0, basically faster, better arrays, and interaction between different languages, object in terms of object layout and foreign interfaces and foreign object layout handling, all those things. There are lots of interesting work going on there, and but I'm not qualified to speak about that. So the two features that that I'm involved in, so that's a high-level overview of what's coming up there. So as I mentioned, a lot of the code is available out there, a lot of documents are available out there. It's OpenJDK, so you're welcome to take a look, participate. You can sign up for mailing lists or other forums, contribute code, send your resume. We are hiring. So that's all I had. If you have questions, I'm happy to answer them. And See, that in itself doesn't do much, right? What does that buy you by saying not extends object? What does that buy you over and above saying value? On the other hand, I would say that sticking in a keyword value there expresses intent, serves a certain documentation purpose. So that in itself, I don't see a benefit there. Values can hold objects. Yeah, values can hold references. So as their fields. Yeah. See, hold on. So to return to this. So a value, codes like a class. So you can declare fields. The fields that you declare can be primitives, can be values, can be references. If you have references there, right? So going back to the cursor example, right? If you have references there, the representation for references doesn't change. So the value now is going to hold a pointer into the heap object that the reference object is, right? But if I have a value that declares a field which is a value, the inner value would get inlined into the outer value because there is no heap representation with pointers there. It's inline data, which also means that a value class cannot declare a field of its own type, right? Unless your linked list implementation is a good example, right? So you have a node and that says pointer next, node next, right? Or your tree representation, right? Left and right. That becomes possible with references. You can't do such a thing because the moment the values are in line. So if a value class, value instance, value type declares a field that's its own type, that inlining would proceed indefinitely, and you know the compiler will actually refuse to do that and throw an error if you do that. So respecting that particular limitation, a value class codes like a class. So it can have fields. Fields can be references, values, or other values or primitives. When you store references, you're storing the references in the pointer. The actual payload, the object itself, is in the heap, very much like it is today. And you will have to chase that pointer into the heap to reach into the actual object data. Adding new keywords will add the overhead of. Any feature that gets added to the language, there is a learning curve, right? So this is, well, any linguistic feature that gets added to the language has a learning curve. So new constructs, new keywords, new syntax, new semantics. I don't think we are at a point where I cannot think of a scheme where the compiler and the runtime can divine automatically what the programmer wanted. It does in a number of ways, and you know, gives you better optimized programs. Even when you write sloppy code, the compilers transform that into better code. Some things are possible, some things are not going to be possible. The programmer has to express an intent to tag something. So that goes back to the early part of this talk where I asked the question, can the VM automatically change the layout so that locality of reference is guaranteed? VM cannot, because objects get passed around all over the place. And you know, I can pass it to method foo, which passes to bar, which passes to bars, and bars can now synchronize. And the VM has a limited scope. At runtime, you can incur only so much penalty to analyze programs because the return on the investment must be good for you to do invest. So there's very limited options are available for the thing to just automatically give better thing. So, which means that constructs are going to be added, language is going to evolve, everything. If you look at any of the releases, right, where linguistic constructs have been added, right? So Java 8, Streams API, requires a new way of thinking, and that new way of thinking, I look at Streams-based code in my own project, and it took me a while to make the mental model shift to understand that code, and I don't write that code even today, right? My colleagues write that code, and I don't write that code today. If I have to write code, I write like Java 7 code, and which is fine, accepted and all that, but people write that code, and lambdas, you need to learn the syntax semantics and all that. And it's not a problem that's going to go away. Not really. Okay, that's a problem, and the way the problem is being tackled is by saying that recognizing keywords only in limited contexts. For example, Java 8 introduces, Java 9 introduces lots of keywords, the module system thing, right? So exports and uses, provides, all those things, right? Requires module system, module info file requires a lot of new keywords to be added. But those keywords are recognized as keywords only inside module info file. Your rest of the program can say exports, and it can be a valid variable name, right? Likewise, I would imagine that whatever is the final choice of keyword that's decided upon, one way to handle that is to say that in the only if it occurs in the modifier position of a class, right? So this is actually the example that I showed. It's featuring in the like public, final, static. Those are all modifiers for a class. If it annotations, if it features there, treat that as a new keyword. Otherwise, treat that as an identifier is one possible approach. The same problem was handled in 1.5 when enumerations and asserts were introduced, right? They introduced two new keywords, enum and assert, to become a keyword. And compilers have provided a way of saying, you know, throw an error if they are used as keyword or as identifier or accept them. So they have provided some transition path. See, I don't have the particular example in mind. So there is this example that shows that even in Java 5, in the SDK, JDK, there are some gaps in generifying, right? Instead of the exact thing, instead of encoding the type variable, people have encoded object there. So you will have a problem. So the compiler is not going to be able to specialize such methods. So the type variable, for specialization to kick in, the type variable must carry a specifier any, and must be used in the signatures of the method and field declarations and so on and so forth. Yes. Yes. So you can have a plain class, not a generic class. Can have a plain class that today declares a generic method. You can modify the type variable with any, and the compiler will basically, at this point in time, what it does is it spits out a separate class to hold that method and does some magic there. I think that implementation is also changing, but yes, it is possible. But generic methods can be specialized, so just as methods can be generic independent of the holding class being generic or not. Specialization, so the term that's being pushed is anyfying, like generifying. So a method can be anyfied independently of its holding class. So that's a horrendously, that introduces a lot of complications in the implementation of the compiler. But the whole story is, let's take the hit, if it results in a simpler user model, as opposed to banning things and, you know, documenting, you can't do this, you can't do this, you can't do this. Somebody had a question. Yeah. Say that again, if that's so. I'm going to completely punt on that. I know next to nothing about serialization. But I can follow up on that, and if you're interested, let me know. I'll follow up on that and share what the story is. All right. So basically, at the moment, this is still an evolving prototype. At the moment, there is when you declare a value class, it internally extends Java-lang value. Okay, a new base type for the value hierarchy is being created. Like, you know, enumerations, all of them extend Java-lang enumeration. So in a similar fashion, there is a Java-lang value that's being introduced as a base class, and that holds two-string hash code and equals, and nothing else. So basically, the rest of the object methods are not applicable, and these are available. See, that's a runtime check, right? Instance of is a runtime check, and it necessarily operates on. Okay. It is possible. It would be the equivalent syntax. It doesn't. I that's interesting. I can feed that back. There, ft and t instance of something is, yeah. T instance of object, yeah. So I can feed that. I'm sorry. No. I can feed that back, but I think there is going to be other complications. As in, you know, what I showed you is just one example. Like where ft, I think there are that syntax has more to it, not just whether something is a reference of this. I think it allows you to say where this is boolean or something, right? I don't have the full syntax. Say that again. See this, I don't know, but in general, the new language constructs are going to be there. Where is not a loop? Where is where a loop? Where is where a loop? There's no where in Java. Anyway, if any new constructs that are going to be introduced, they're going to make sure it doesn't clash with such a thing, right? If there's no loop in Java by name there, but if it is there, that needs to be a story for harmony. But you need to, saying it without being judgmental, you need to get hold of the fact that you're going to have to learn new syntax. We can happily code. I am very happy coding in Java 1.4, but that's not possible anymore. See, hold on. The array of values, the array itself is not immutable. The array is very much mutable. Array is a reference type, right? So if I say array of 5, take one cell, that at this point is holding a certain value. I can make that change to hold some other value. That's possible because arrays are references. Correct. See, it's the same problem as if I have int x equals 5. Can I change x? You can change x to hold some other value, but you can't change 5 itself. 5 will stay 5 till eternity. So that's the same thing. So the array itself is mutable. Like, you can change the X and Y. Yeah, that's not possible. Correct, at the construction time. Once it's constructed, it's immutable. See, the complications come from the point of view of codes like a class, works like an int. So if I pass a value to a method, it's passed by value, right? As in, it's passed in registers and whatever, and if modifications were to be allowed, those modifications won't reflect at the call site. And that, for reference, for what look codes like a class, that would be a very confusing thing. Right, so that's why they're not allowed. It's immutable on account of that. If it codes like a class and the called method is allowed to modify it and the modification doesn't reflect at the call site, it's going to be very confusing. So just declare them immutable, being user defined primitives. So all right. Thank you very much. Yeah, last question. See, I must confess, I don't know the plans for that. That inquiry. I mean, I don't know the plan. As in, I don't even know what goes into Oracle JDK. I work on OpenJDK. So, it's entirely speculative. Like the very first slide said, it's entirely speculative. It's very likely, we are very interested, we are strongly motivated to make it happen. There's a lot of effort and investigative work that's going into it. If you rewind the clock back, all the major features that have shipped in Java over many different releases have come in the same fashion. So lambdas were in cooking for quite a while. So it's not like, you know, people said, okay, Java 7 shipped and let's start with Java 8 and what do we want to do? No. When Java 6 was going on, lambdas, you know, the very first implementation of closures, which lambdas are in a way of looking at it, happened in 1978 or something, right? It's a roughly 40-year-old feature in a way of looking at it. So the investigation work has been going on. Module systems has been in the cooking for quite some time. Like that. So these are being actively prototyped and researched. They will very likely show up at some time. And we are strongly motivated to have it happen. But, you know, the dates, we don't know. JDK 10, it may not be 11. We don't know. We don't want to commit to that. It will hopefully show up soon. But it's highly speculative. If you, none of the officially published JDK bits will carry this. And they will, there is a process, the Java community process, which needs to, this needs to be fed through that with expert groups formed, and you know, they will get to debate the feature at various points. A lot of times the feature gets changed quite a bit during the JCP process before it. So a lot of community participation, experts comments and all that. It's not something that someone sitting in an island puts together and throws it at the world. Right. All right. Thank you very much. Lots of familiar faces. I enjoyed being here.